Hello everyone, today we'll see how we can do a bit of UI for our game. So we'll tackle both the player UI, something that is on screen, or WorldSpace UI, so UI that is related to each individual entity in the game world. As usual, you can get the health folder health bars in the GitHub repository linked in the description below, and open the health bar scene and look at the subscene, where we have two slimes which make use of the game object companion altering that we've seen in the previous episode, that will spawn a slime prefab, and that slime prefab contains the slime and all the UI for the health bar. So since I don't want all of this to clutter my entity, I'm putting them as a child of my game object, so that when I have my game object companion that is instantiated, I will only have all of these three components. And actually, I could even have another parent to just add the health bar controller, because I don't really need to have the reference to the mesh filter and mesh renderer from the entity side. But I will leave it like that for this example. Going back to the scene, so the second entity is exactly the same, and I have a third entity, which is my player, and that player only has the player authoring component that we've seen in a previous episode, and that has 5 health points. In the resources, you have the UI document that I've implemented for the player UI. It's just a simple progress bar with 2 buttons to increase and decrease the health, and that we will use in our mono behavior. There is also the UI toolkit folder. I believe it comes by default with a new project, but I've added it since I'm using the panel setting and I don't want for you to have set up anything. So if I enter play mode, we can see that the slimes get their health updated, and the lives for our player is updated only when I press one of the 2 buttons, plus or minus. In the console, same thing, we can see that we have the updating player UI and updating enemy UI that is logged. And you can notice here that we are updating the enemy UI continuously and the player UI only when I press on the button. So we'll see how we can handle these changes with the change filter feature of ECS. For this episode, we don't have any authoring or new ECS components. We just have mono behaviors, the health bar controller, which is a very simple component that just references the sliders that I need to update for the enemy UI, and that does a bit of billboarding, so making sure that the slider for the UI is always facing the camera so that I have a nice UI. And it provides a method that we will call from an ECS system that just computes the relative health that the entity has remaining and set it as the slider value. For the other component, or the other mono behavior, what we have in the player UI is actually a singleton mono behavior. So if you are not aware of the pattern, you can create a singleton mono behavior like that. So whenever we have that, we can just call the instance to get this particular mono behavior, and it needs to only have one in the scene. We have the UI document. After that, I'm actually creating a query field, entity query field. And as part of the start method, I'm registering the actions that I need to perform when I click on the add button or the decrease button, which are my 2 buttons in the GUI. And for the query, I'm actually getting an entity query that matches the player type of component. So here I'm getting the ability to reference all the entities that have the player component. And since I only have one entity that has the player component, it will be a singleton entity. When I'm clicking on decrease, I'm decreasing the health. So for that, I can get the player component. So here, if I just do query get singleton player component, I can update the player component and set again the singleton. Another way to do the same thing, or to to actually increase the health here is to use the query get singleton RW, and in that case I get a ref RW and can update directly through the value RW, kind of like we do in for each systems, to update the life count of my player. And the last method is again a method to set the progress bar, so it's the equivalent of the slider from Canvas, but progress bar is for UI Toolkit, and I'm just setting the percentage that I get from my system. Speaking of system, we can actually take a look at the system, and here I want to make a quick note that if you look at the systems, we only have one file that is called display life system, but if we look inside, we actually have two systems that are even named slightly differently than the file. So that's one difference that we have with mono behaviors, because mono behaviors, we can only have one of them inside a file, and the file has to be named the same thing as the mono behavior itself. So for ECS and for system, this constraint is lifted. We can name our files however we want and our system however we want. So two systems, one for handling the player life and one for handling the enemy life. So let's take a look first at the player life system. And for this one, I'm using for each with the player as a reference. I get the player component as read-only. And we'll see in a minute what is the change filter player. And if I have my mono behavior singleton, if it exists, or rather if it does not exist, I just return and continue. I log the fact that I'm updating the player UI and I'm actually setting the health of my player. Now for the enemy life system, same thing, I'm using the for each statement with the else component, the else bar controller, which is, as a reminder, the mono behavior that I've set here and that will handle the update of the slider for me. And since it's a mono behavior, I'm doing like in the previous episode, system API, manage API, Unity Engine component to actually get a reference to that mono behavior component from my entity. And again, I'm using the with change filter on the else ECS component. And for each entity, I'm iterating over. I'm setting the else from my HBAR controller, so updating the slider. And again, logging the update enemy UI in the console. So the change filter here means that this component or this system, this particular for each loop, will only run if the player component in that case and the else component in that case have changed. But it's not actually that they changed. Actually, it's that they've been accessed to be changed. So if I take a look at my scene and play it, we can see that the player UI is not updated, but the enemy UI is still updated. Even though if I look at my actual entity, the else is not being updated because the value is not changing. In reality, the change filter is not able to detect a change in value of the component, but it can only detect the fact that the component was accessed. And one additional information, it is not running on a per entity basis, meaning that these two entities, since I only have two, are most likely in the same chunk of memory. We can refer back to previous and other videos about the chunk memory allocation and how it works. But what we care about here is the fact that if one of the entities that have the else component is accessed with ref RW access, it will consider that the component has been updated. So that's why we keep updating the UI system. And in fact, it's correct because we are continuously trying to update it through the else region system that we have done in the first episode. If I disable that system, so if I prevent it from updating and look back at my console, I can see that the change filter is now taking effect because this component is no longer accessed anywhere in the game with a reference read-write access. And for the player UI, in fact, I have no system that updates it. It's only updated with the click on the button. So that's why it's not continuously updating. If you want to learn more about how this change filter is handled, you can have a look at this blog post, which was made by another early adopter of Unity Dots and goes into great detail about how you can handle this change filter and how it works. So even though it's from 2019, the content is still very much relevant. There may be old reference to all the components or old APIs, but the principle remains the same. There is several versions that are tracked at different points in the system, before system, after system, and so on. So if you want to have a more detailed explanation of how all this work, I highly recommend this blog post, which explains it very, very well. And that's actually all I have for you today. So don't forget to like and share the video if you like the content. As usual, you can support me through the affiliate link in the description below. If you are interested in any asset of the asset store, there are plenty of sales all the time, so don't forget to check out also the publisher of the week. I'm posting a tweet every week about that if you want to get reminded. Or if you want to provide more direct support to me, you can make a single donation or monthly subscription on my Ko-fi page, also linked in the description below. And I will see you in the next episode to handle the last piece we need for our game, which is actually the scene management, to be able to make several levels and a nice intro and a new scene. So see you in the next episode.